So it says them.
Thank you. Before we start, I want to say thank you to everybody this morning for joining us today, especially STCU for sponsoring this event as well. Today, we're probably going to be talking about a subject that is near and dear to our hearts and our minds. But before we jump in, I want to thank Logan and the Chamber for having us as guest speakers as well. Just to kind of piggyback on Logan, we are Sonar Insights. We are market research strategy consultancy here in the Tri-Cities. We specialize in really in uncovering aspects. You want to learn about your customers, your business, and competition to help transform your business for growth. That's kind of our MO. That's what we love to do. Again, my name is Sunny Varagpanyu, and I'm going to turn it over to Aaron Welling, also our co-founder as well, to kind of get the whole presentation started. So over to you, Aaron.
All right. Good morning, everybody. Very excited to be talking to all of you today. When we were given this topic a few weeks ago, the thought was, taking advantage of change with everything going on with COVID. It's like, yeah, well, it's kind of the tail end, no big deal, but we'll talk about change anyway. And then lo and behold, we get a new mandate from Governor Inslee. So we still have change. We're still forced. We still have change forced upon us. And because of all that change, it requires us to adapt. And, a lot of times people fear change, but we want to talk today about taking advantage of change and why that's important and how you can do that to better yourself and better your business. So hopefully everybody can see my screen. And away we go. So we want to talk about taking advantage of change. And over the past 15 years, Sunny and I have helped numerous companies around the world view change as a positive. We've got a few principles that we want to share with you that will help you navigate the times ahead and make accepting change an advantage for you. We've summarized those five principles here. The first principle is change is scary, but it's better than the alternative. This is where we explain why change is good and why you should look at it as something that you should embrace. The second thing is that second principle is that change can lead to growth if you navigate it well. And we're gonna show you what you can do to make change a catalyst for growth. Number three, change must be studied since it affects us in many ways. We're going to show you how you can study change to learn where those impacts are for your business. Principle four is that change should impact your decisions, making you pivot your plans. We'll talk about how embracing change can help you be more confident in the strategy that you choose, both for your business and for your life. And then principle five is that change can inspire new solutions, helping your business evolve. We'll talk about what that looks like for delivering new value to your customers. So we've got a lot to cover. So let's get it started. Sunny, back to you.
Perfect. Thank you. So let's set the stage here. What we want to do is that, today everybody works in a different business from each other on this call. So what we want to do is bring everything kind of together. So let's do a little bit of role playing here. So what we want to do is work in very different businesses from each other, but the principles that we're going to share today work across any business and any industry. So to illustrate that, what we're going to do is apply the principles we talk about with one specific type of business. So today, everyone on this call is a dog groomer, okay? You love dogs, you love pets, you love anything that has four legs or wings, okay? So for pet lovers, this might be a little easier for you. For those that aren't, you'll still get biased. So just kind of think of all the loved ones that you have, your friends that are pet owners, put yourselves in those shoes. So let's set the stage properly here. Can you click, Aaron? So you're a pet groomer here in the Tri-Cities. For 10 years, you're a premier pet grooming operation. You've been around for 10 years, brick and mortar business. You developed a nice clientele and you're successful for what you're doing. You got employees that depend on you and this is your sole source of income. So that's who you are. So if you can think of some cool names for your business, we settled with Pampered Pets here for the business that you are all a part of today. So again, as a smart business owner, you've already established a few things for your business, which is your vision and your mission. So today, as a pet grooming entrepreneur, your vision is Pamper Pets with world-class grooming service. So pretend, you know, you're offering four season type service for your pets. Imagine them, they're going to in to get massages, having ice or cucumbers on their eyelids and et cetera. That's what you're trying to give. And the mission is to provide the best products and services and experience to all pets in the Tri-Cities. In addition to that, you know, your product offering is giving a spa-like experience to your pets, providing all the amenities that you would receive if you were a pet. And the target here is, you know, people that are willing to pay for it, a little older demographic, and those are pretty affluent. And pets are a huge part of the family. I mean, it's fun to see pets be a part of family when, you know, you're loving them, you're holding them, and, you know, they do everything with you. So that's kind of where we're at with your business.
All right. So now that you've got your business and you understand what your business, here's the first thing that happens. You're faced with change. And many times with change, we get scared. We often have knee-jerk reactions. We think of it as a fight or flight scenario. And that's really natural because we're faced with lots of things going through our head when we experience change. Sometimes change makes us think that we're going to lose money, we're going to lose customers, we're going to lose employees. Sometimes change means we have new competition or that they're getting stronger in the market. Sometimes it's technology or regulations, which makes us have to shift how we operate, or our supply chain is getting disrupted. There are a ton of things that might be affecting us that are requiring us to change. The reality is, as change arises, many businesses are going to fail. It's Darwinian. It's survival of the fittest. But the good thing about change is that the strong survive. And the reason why they survive is because at the side of change and the risk of failure, they start to ask questions of how to survive. First, they look at the why. Why are we in business? Do we have a true vision and mission to succeed? If they have one of those, it's a lot easier to survive and for the long run. Second, they look at who is our customer. How are they changing? Is it somebody different than it was before? Third, what are the best opportunities that we should pursue because of the change that we're experiencing? Is it something new? Is it something different? Is it something that we just need to enhance that we're already getting done? Next, when should we pursue those opportunities? We all know that timing is everything. Sometimes it's a short-term opportunity, sometimes it's a long-term opportunity, but understanding the when is imperative. Next is the how. How can we leverage our capabilities? How can we leverage what we're inherently good at to make our business grow and to take advantage of this change? And finally, where can we be better in everything that we do? Where are the improvements that we should that should come about because of this change? What we've seen in the past is the businesses that embrace change are the ones that thrive. Companies like Blockbuster, Kodak, Kmart, all of them ignored change and they paid the price. But businesses that are set up well and question what they can do in spite of change are the ones that really will thrive and will grow. So let's get back to our analogy then. Here you are, you're a pet groomer, and then COVID hits, and your business is disrupted. You're not essential. You can't open your doors, but this is your livelihood. You need to employ yourself and those other people. Plus, you've got a building and equipment that you need to pay for. In short, you really need to stay in business. So how can you use this change to your benefit? Well, when change happens around us, we need to think back to those questions we can ask about our business. In this case, we first answer the why. Why are we in business? How does the impact of COVID change our business and why? And does it change our why? The next question is the who are our customers? How will they change? Do we have new customers as a result of this? Do we have different customers? What are they going through that is something that we need to look at and facing their needs? The next one is what? What are the new opportunities because of COVID? Are there things that we can do differently because of this that opened up new ways to grow and transform our business? The next question is when? When is the right time? Are these opportunities short-term or are they long-term? Is this something that we need to take advantage of now or later? The next question is the how. How can we leverage what we do well to pursue those opportunities that are ahead of us? And then the last one is where. Where can we improve? Where can we improve all that we're doing in spite of change so that we can continue to retain customers and maintain our business? So change helps us to ask the right questions that get us to understanding what we need to do to push forward in transforming our business and getting the growth that we're looking for.
So now that we set the stage on, you know, what our business is and how COVID has changed how our business needs to react, we can now really visualize what the growth path is. How can change lead to growth? How do we navigate it? What should we do? So Aaron and I have done this, you know, for multiple companies and helped navigate them through this, but you have to embrace change first. And now we have to navigate the path of change. By understanding the world around you, you can transform your business now. So to get the growth you want, it starts with embracing change, like I said before, and recognizing it can be the catalyst to growth. Once you've done that, you can start down this path. So step one, navigating change, is to study it. This means research. So at Sonar Insights, our mantra is everything should start with research. When you have the data behind you, you can make better decisions. Step two is to understand the impact. When you understand the impact of change, it helps you to formulate a plan or strategy that will drive your business forward. Step three is to create new solutions. This means innovation. Means adapting to change in the market to capture new growth opportunities. So as you can see, this three-step process is the blueprint and the process that we've used to navigate companies through the change and get the benefits that they want. So we're going to share that out with our pet grooming analogy here. So kind of you can see how the process works throughout your pet business.
All right. So to make sure we understand change, we need to study it first, like Sunny said. So there's lots of things to look at to make sure we're recognizing all the change out there. In essence, we need to look through multiple lenses to get the full picture of what's going on. The goal is to build a viewpoint of the world so you can figure out how to adapt to it. The major lenses to look through are first, your customer and how their needs and wants are changing and what new customers look like. The next one is your competition. Whether they're direct competition or indirect competition, you need to know how they're changing and how they're trying to take your market share. The third one is technology. This can often be the biggest disruptor to business, both in good ways and in bad ways. So understanding how technology is changing is important to make sure that you are tracking it. Regulatory. While often overlooked, this can affect us in both negative and positive ways. Regulatory is one of those things that has come down the pike with COVID and is affecting us greatly, which is one of the things we're talking about in our analogy here. And then the third one is the value chain. What's happening both up and down that value chain can affect exactly how you respond. Now, those causes of change can lead us to make sure we're looking at the right effects, because any type of cause creates an effect. So the effects of change are, what does the market look like? How does our brand need to change? What are the new business models that we need to look like? How is the overall environment changing? And last but certainly not least, what are the offerings that we need to have out there to make sure that we're responding to the changes that are there? So you look at all those different ways to research, all those different lenses that you need to look through. And as you start to look at that, you can map that back to your business. So we're going to do that now for our pet grooming business, right? So first off, we need to look at our customers. What does it mean for our customers as we look at that research? Well, interesting part about COVID is that it has actually created more pet owners. Pounds became empty, shelters became empty. And a lot of people were getting pets. Why? Because they've got more time at home, because their kids are home, because they want to learn a skill, and people are craving some interaction. And so pets provide that for them. So two very interesting aspects of customers that are changing in this environment. You've also got a huge demand for at-home convenience with Uber Eats, grocery delivery. People are looking at those and accepting them a lot more. People are also getting those services on demand. You've got an increased spend on labor because people are wanting to do that. You've also got more disposable income on things that they didn't used to do because they used to go out to restaurants, they used to go out to shows, they used to go out to all different things, but they can't do that anymore. So people have a little bit more money to spend on things that they didn't previously. All right, what else have we got with our pet grooming business? Well, we've got the competition. Online vendors are up. Chewy's been putting out a lot of commercials these days to try to get everybody to buy through them. You've also got Amazon. You've also got those big box stores that are still open and selling a ton of stuff. But you've also got YouTube and TikTok out there for all those DIYers. You want to learn how to groom your pet, want to learn how to do this stuff because you got time on your hands? Well, that's not direct competition, but that's indirect competition. And it definitely can take a toll on you as people think that they can do this then. This pet grooming thing themselves. You've also got, so then we look at technology. And technology here, you've got everybody on their cell phones, everybody on their smartphones, and they helping to connect people together. You've got people spending a lot more time on social media. And so those social media channels are seeing a huge influx of people spending more time than they had there in the past. And then technology brings us access to experts on YouTube, on TikTok, on Masterclass, people that are in the know that are now a click away explaining what they need to do with their pets. All things that we need to look at as we are looking at the change that's happening because of COVID. With regulatory, we've got mask mandates and we've got social distancing. People can't open their businesses because they're non-essential. Those are things that are affecting our business. And then we've got the value chain. We've got access and acceptance to home delivery of goods, which really wasn't as accepted previously. And then we've got lack of access to services and experiences that people used to have before. So looking at all these different changes that are happening helps us to realize that there are opportunities for our business, things that we can take advantage of based on how the world is changing around us.
So now that we understand how this new world looks, we can map those changes back to our business. So we need to really understand how change should impact our decisions moving forward. Because these are gonna lead to growth opportunities. Typically companies, they get very fixed on one change over the other, but it's really a combination of them. You can look at them like alternate realities when you kind of bundle them all together. And all these all affect the aspects of your business, including your mission, your vision, your values, and especially how you stay true to your business. It affects your brands and your products and services and how you respond to customers. And even down to your business units, the capabilities that you have, the technology, and how you operate and execute day to day. So it's very important to really understand change holistically and how it impacts various aspects and levels of your business. And we'll show you that in the next slide. So as Aaron explained, there's multiple layers and lenses of changes, as you can see on the far left. You know, we talked about online vendorship, people spending more time at home, people having more disposable income, people wanting to be pampered, having their pets pampered and things like that. So in this alternate world that we've created, the vision, the mission slightly has changed because of all these changes due to COVID. You know, people have more accessibility to services. They want high-end services still with the experience, but how do we deliver that, right? So what we've done here is that our vision has slightly changed. We still want to pamper pets and give them four-season service, but with more disposable income, people being at home and wanting that same experience, we want to give the owner the same experience as well. So as you can see, our vision has slightly changed. Pamper pets and their owners with world-class service, giving them the four-season treatment, giving the owners the same best service products in the Tri-Cities as well as their pets. So what does that mean? If we're moving our vision and mission slightly that way, these means that there's these multiple opportunities on the other end by combining all these changes to your business. So what could it mean? It could mean a mobile pet grooming service where we come to your door and give your pets, you know, the service that they would normally get at the brick and mortar. We provide online classes so we teach, you know, everybody to groom their pets the way that we do and give them the best service and best experience possible. Home delivery service. I mean, we can provide all the amenities that we have at our brick and mortar to everyone out there that wants it. Or we can expand outside the Tri-Cities, right? Looking beyond the walls, you know, where we operate and things like that, because we can. We could do a pickup and drop off pet service where, you know, if you need more time to yourself and wanted to have your pets, you know, pampered, we can do that. We can have it be ultra exclusive, meaning that, you know, with minimum people to be in our brick and mortar, we make it very, very premium, right? Where you get the 5-season service instead of the 4-season service. Or, you know, we can go do owner pet spa experience because we can get to you, get to your pets, and give you that treatment that you deserve, right?
All right, so once you've recognized the new opportunities that are out there, it's time to create new solutions that can satisfy customer needs. This is where innovation comes in. And historically, change has been the catalyst for new innovation. From Johannes Gutenberg to John Deere to Bill Gates to Mark Zuckerberg, those that have invented and innovated have done so because of change in the market. Anyone can create new offerings as they seek to fill customer needs. It's simply a matter of finding new ways to deliver value. You can do that through lots of different ways. You can do it through new offerings with technology, product, or service innovation. You can do it with new delivery of those products through business model innovation. You can do it through new experiences, through marketing and social media or social innovation. You can form new connections through brand innovation, and you can create new influencers through channel innovation. The ways to innovate are numerous, but they become they come because of change. It was the 2008 crash that caused companies like Airbnb and Uber to come about. People were looking at saving money. How do we do this? Ride sharing, home sharing came about. Those companies are billion-dollar businesses now. And it came because that innovation came because of the change that was happening around them. So we've got to innovate. Innovate or die, that's right. So as we innovate, we need to look across all the different things that we can do within those different aspects that we talked about previously. So let's do this with our pet grooming business, right? Our new offering could be a spa at home offering. We get a mobile pet grooming service, plus we add an owner spa service. We make sure that it's customized for their unique needs so the pet and the owner get what they want. We also offer delivery of products, which can include setup or demonstration of those products if needed. We're going to maximize our online presence because that's where people are now, right? We're focusing on Facebook plus Instagram to get the attention that we want. Our business model is going to move to virtual at the front end, because we don't need that brick and mortar piece, with online scheduling and booking and a contactless service wherever possible. Our brand is going to be a little bit more exclusive, but still accessible, and it's going to become much more service oriented as a brand. And finally, we need to integrate with suppliers, working with the big name companies as well as local ones. We're going to partner with salons so that the pet and the owner service is done well. And finally, we want to work with the health department to ensure that we follow any regulations that they have for interactions with customers. We just blew out one big offering of that spa at home where the owner and the pet gets that service. And this is just one example of how you can look at innovating based on the change that you see around you.
So, you know, what are the benefits for taking advantage of change? I mean, there's two aspects to it. Change can come as benefits can come in the form of for your customers. When you take advantage of change, it shows that you're not afraid. Change, when you embrace it, and it demonstrates, you know, that the customer comes first when you look at change in the right way. It provides confidence that you will always be around, and also builds brand awareness, loyalty, and reputation. Your customers are going to ultimately thank you for it. When you embrace change, you run at it full speed and not be afraid of it. So, and on the other end, for your organization, when you embrace change, you navigate it, you create the right strategies, structures, and the right offerings, it's going to insulate you from competition because you're so far ahead because you've done all the right legwork and things like that. And it directs your growth from data, and it's measurable. That you can measure the change and how it affects your business. And ultimately, it leads to informed and faster decision-making for your business to pivot when you need to. And when you pivot, it creates a greater sense of alignment there too, because everybody knows where you're headed. So that's the benefits of embracing change and making sure change goes throughout your entire business. So to recap, what should you take away? Change is good, so embrace it. Change is navigable. There's a method to the madness, especially how we've illustrated from, you know, do the research, create the strategy, and develop the new products and offerings that you need to do. Change needs to be researched. So look at change through lenses, not just from a very centralized focus. Look at holistically and how you need to respond to those changes. You need to map those changes. So generating new strategies, new realities, what are the potential opportunities moving forward for your organization? So you can start to align yourself in the right way. And change leads to growth. So developing new solutions to your new world, to your new customers, against your new competition. So all in all, change is great, but let's figure out how to go through those changes and come out on the back end with growth.
All right. So we want to hammer this point home, but it's really important in our minds. So we want to close with a quote, which is that the secret of change is to focus all your energy not on fighting the old, but building the new. Sunny and I talk a lot. We are pretty fast talkers, which is why we've got all this extra time left over. But that means that we've got lots of time for any type of questions that anybody might have.
Perfect. Thank you for covering that. That was really interesting to follow along with. And very relevant, I would say, especially right now. I think this was in one of the first slides you guys covered. I didn't get the slide number, but what would you say to a business owner who is maybe afraid to embrace change?
Stop it. No, it's, you know, it's rational. It's very rational to be afraid of change. But we all know that change is where growth actually happens. And so you have to look at it in bite-sized chunks. You can't, a lot of times change gets overwhelming. So what I would say is just look at it from lots of different lenses, look at it from different aspects and things that you can control and take advantage of. And if you start to map it out little piece by piece, you can start to eat that elephant and, you know, recognize that it's not outside of your control. There's lots of things that you can do. So it's just a matter of picking picking it apart piece by piece so that you can manage the change that's out there and figure out how to adapt to it.
Yeah, and to piggyback off of that as well, Aaron, and to whoever asked the question, I know that, you know, when you first started, you know, your business or, you know, your role, you did it because of change. You saw something that needed to change in the world and you decided to do it. So in the beginning, it was scary, of course, but now that you've had an established business or whatnot, you get hit by change because you're faced with doing the day-to-day normal routine and now something happens, right? So just kind of embrace it how you did in the past years before you started. I think of that mindset and mentality that you had and apply that to today, and that will help you bridge the gap of being scared of change.
Perfect, thank you. And then the last one is another question. What advice would you give to somebody who's working through this process and hits a wall? What would their approach be if that happens?
Well, a lot of times when you hit the wall, it's a good thing. And those walls come about because at the end of the day, this is hard. If it wasn't hard, everybody would do it. It would be easy. And, you know, it wouldn't be worth the struggle at the end of the day. But, you know, hitting that wall is a good thing. It means that you're somewhere that somebody else may not have been and might have stopped. Take that wall and figure out how to climb it. Figure out how to get around it, and, you know, push through it, because, you know, walls are meant to get over. Walls are meant to come down. I think it shows character when we hit a wall and we just continue to plug through it. Sometimes it means taking a break and, you know, looking at it from a different angle, but, you know, it's good to hit walls. It means you're where nobody else has been before.
And typically those walls come from not knowing what to do, meaning that the process that we've outlined is great. You can try to go through it and things like that. Sorry, I hope this doesn't sound like a plug, but there's different techniques to get over some of those barriers, some of those challenges within the process. So when you're looking at, you know, for example, research, right? Typically somebody will say, hey, go do some research. That is not very helpful, right? So it's how you do the research and how, or the reasons why you want to get answers to some questions. And that typically drives the tactics on what you need to do. So if you really want to learn about your competition, what is the research that you're going to do? Why are you doing that research and how are you going to do that research? If you want to learn about your customers, why do you want to do that? And how are you going to provide the right correct tactics or implement the right techniques to get the insights that you want? So typically that's where walls are or barriers are created. But in order to get over it, you have to create the right techniques to do that. So for us, I mean, we've lived in it day in, day out for the last 13, 15 years. So we have provided organizations with the right techniques to get over those walls. So it just depends on the wall that you're trying to get over, and we can get over it. So hopefully that answers that question.
Yeah, no, thank you both. I hope everyone had a chance to take down Sunny and Aaron's information. This is a very interesting topic, I think, and something that, again, I've said this 25 times already, probably. It's really relevant, especially right now. So feel free to take down their information. Sunny and Aaron, thank you both for your time today. It was a fantastic presentation. if you guys, any of you want to come back and rewatch this later on, it's going to be posted on our Facebook page later, probably in a few minutes. And I just want to end by saying again, thank you, Sunny and Aaron. Thank you to STCU, our program partner. And I hope everyone has a great rest of your day.
Thank you, Logan.
Thank you, Logan. Thank you, everybody. We really appreciate the time and wish you the best of luck during these interesting changes. But thank you again.
Yeah, no problem. Have a good day.